shooting.
Violence in Baltimore City, where 16 people, you heard that right, shot over the weekend alone. That includes a Little Italy restaurant owner and a man found shot in the head along Interstate 95. WJZ investigator Mike Helgren live along that stretch of I-95 in southwest Baltimore with much more on what we're learning about the shooting there. Mike.
Rick, MDTA police are handling this investigation. They're calling it a suspected homicide. Now, the victim was traveling southbound here along Interstate 95 out of the city. They believe he was by himself. They originally thought that this was a car crash. They later learned he'd been shot. Do you feel safe?
Me? I'm not safe at all.
People are frustrated and fed up after another violent weekend in Baltimore with at least 16 shot from Friday through Sunday. Five of those victims were killed. That includes a mass shooting in the 1800 block of West Lafayette Avenue. Among the four victims, a 21-year-old woman who was just driving down the street Friday.
It's not safe in the city no more. It's not safe anywhere in the city. It's like the killing is coming like from the inner city. And it's just spread.
Early Sunday morning, just after 4:30, police responded to what they thought was a single car crash on I-95 at Caton Avenue. Instead, they found 25-year-old Sai Charan Naka from Hanover, Anne Arundel County, shot in the head inside his Hyundai SUV. Doctors pronounced him dead at shock trauma. MDTA police shut down the interstate for several hours. They're still looking for witnesses, but have not said whether the motive was road rage or something else.
The blood is being shed, and it's really like nothing that nobody can do to stop it. Even the police, probably not even the National Guard. To me, because like I say, it's like the kids out here now was ready for war.
It's just crazy out here. It's one thing at the next thing, man.
A plea for the bloodshed to end.
And try to get everyone on the same page so we can fix the city. We can have a good city, man. We have a lot of talent here, man. We just got to stick together as a whole. We need to just come together, man, and stop this violence.
Now, the victim here along I-95 was driving a 2022 Hyundai Tucson SUV. MDTA police say that they've recovered some evidence, but they're looking for more tips. If you know anything, you're asked to call them. Live in southwest Baltimore, Mike Helgren, WJZ.
From standoffs to armed robberies, Metro Police had a busy weekend. Saturday, first responders pulled a body out of the Oklahoma River. No foul play was suspected, and the victim is currently listed as a John Doe. A domestic incident in OKC led to a standoff with police Saturday. The suspect threatened to shoot himself and police. After a few hours, he did surrender. Police are searching for a suspect who hit a woman in the head with a baseball bat, then stole her money. The woman was taken to the hospital. A drive-by shooting also under investigation near Northeast 33rd Street and North Kelly Avenue. The suspect fired shots at a nearby car, and those bullets hit through the driver's side window, then out the windshield. The search still going on for that suspect. Many of these cases still under investigation. Stick with KOCO 5 News for updates.
In downtown Detroit, shootings on Friday and Saturday nights.
And police say they're fed up. The most recent shooting Saturday near Congress and Brush. Officers returning fire in that shootout. And the night before, two bystanders hit in a shooting near Cadillac Square and Randolph.
City officials say people who live outside of Detroit are bringing weapons into the city center. It's sparking a bigger discussion about a plan to prevent gun violence.
7 Action News reporter Simon Chaiquette is live downtown with some answers this afternoon. Simon, if there are any.
Glenda, Brian, what really sticks out here is the fact there was no shortage of officers in the area at the time this happened. In fact, they actually witnessed the shooting.
Downtown is a central place for Detroiters and for visitors to come. That has to be sacred and safe.
Outraged and pledging to rally the community to take another stand against shootings, Pastor Maurice Hardwick blames weekend violence on too many young people carrying guns illegally and a lack of parental supervision.
Monitor your children. Don't send unruly teenagers down here under no supervision without having to talk with them.
Police say three armed suspects on Saturday night came from nearby East Point, and two of them were hit with gunfire during an exchange between them. Two were arrested for allegedly carrying concealed weapons, and police plan to make a third arrest after having to return fire near Sweetwater Tavern on East Congress. Two suspects hospitalized are expected to survive. The chief pointing out a visible presence of police sadly did not deter violence.
I don't think this was a manpower issue. I mean, the officers literally witnessed it. I mean, they were on top of the scene. You know, we've got a very strategic deployment strategy.
This comes after a separate shooting Friday near Cadillac Square, where two people passing by, a 17-year-old girl and 22-year-old man, were shot and also hospitalized. Two suspects in that case remain on the run. Police pledging to implement an updated strategy to ensure public safety. Part of that, arresting spectators who may gather for dangerous driving. A recent video highlighting illegal drifting now being investigated and believed to be posted by someone from Chicago.
We've got young people operating these extremely fast vehicles. I saw the video that you're speaking of. I'm troubled by it, and our crime intelligence units are working it.
Despite all this, the chief maintains that visiting downtown is still safe. He also wants to call attention to the fact that there's been a rise in violent crime all around the country. Glenda, back to you.
Over the city right now, because it's every day is something crazy, somebody losing their life.
Plus, bullets flying several times this weekend in Milwaukee. That is where we begin at 10. A violent weekend in Milwaukee.
Here are the latest numbers. Three people are dead, 14 are injured, and at least a dozen shootings since Friday. One of the shootings was a homicide near 34th and Walnut. Police say a 23-year-old man was shot and killed.
Sam Kramer joins us live tonight outside Milwaukee Police Headquarters. Sam, we just got new information from Milwaukee Police. What can you tell us?
Yeah, hi there, Cassidy. The total that we had with you guys at 9 o'clock was just bumped up by one more. A 39-year-old Milwaukee woman was shot and injured around 7 o'clock tonight near 5th in Burleigh. Milwaukee police believe someone out there has video of that incident. They want them to send it in to them right away. Here's what we know on all of these shootings so far. Just one person is in custody. Milwaukee police tell us they only know they're only looking for one more known suspect as, again, another already violent weekend. It's already been a violent year continues here in Milwaukee.
Near 34th and Galena, evidence markers sit on the sidewalk and between cars on the street. A little after 3:15 Sunday, Milwaukee police tell us someone shot and killed a 23-year-old Milwaukee man here as they're trying to determine what happened leading up to that shooting.
A lot of times when you see things that's happening in the community, they are a result of trauma and barriers that happen in impoverished neighborhoods.
Just 2 hours earlier, our cameras captured a similar scene near 41st and Florist. Neighbors told us off camera they heard dozens of shots following an argument. Police say a 33-year-old man was shot, though his injuries are not considered life-threatening, and detectives are still looking for a known suspect.
It's too close for comfort for me, because that's two doors from my house.
Those shootings came after two men, a 20-year-old and an 18-year-old, were shot and killed Friday night near 37th and Hadley. Neighbors say they're ready for the gun violence to end.
Ain't no reason in the world for that baby to lose his life.
Well, County Supervisor Saquonna Taylor says the best path forward requires all of us to come together.
So I think if we can continue to have unity, not just on this day, but throughout Milwaukee City and County, we will see a drastic change in the numbers decreasing of violence that happens throughout this city.
Bystanders struck by gunfire at a Bay Area bar not long after the Warriors won their NBA championship.
It happened on a busy street in front of a lot of people in downtown Oakland, and it was all caught on surveillance camera.
KPX5's Da Lin has the exclusive video and talked to nervous business owners and neighbors.
Surveillance footage shows the shooting was a targeted hit. The murder victim was standing right next to the van, but stray bullets hit multiple bystanders.
It was a busy night on 14th Street. A lot of people out and about in downtown Oakland. Some were perhaps celebrating the Warriors winning a championship. Just before 10:30 Thursday night, surveillance video showed the victim in the yellow jacket walking near 14th and Harrison. As he was talking to a couple of women, an SUV pulled up on the street. Four gunmen got out and opened fire on him. It appeared a gun was jammed briefly. The driver of the SUV came around and fired a few more shots at the victim as he was on the ground. Here's a different camera angle. Oakland police say the targeted victim died at the scene. So far, no motive. They would only say the victim was a 25-year-old San Francisco man. Police say the shooting injured a woman who was talking to the victim. A bullet grazed a security guard standing in front of the nearby halftime sports bar. Stray bullets also hit two customers inside a different bar.
This had nothing at all to do with any Warriors game. It had nothing to do with
My Bar or 310. It had everything to do with the climate of the Bay Area, with gun violence.
It's unclear where the victim was going or what brought him to 14th Street. The owner of Halftime Sports Bar, James Daly, says he worries for the safety of his customers and staff.
I have three daughters that work in my place, and it scares me to death that this is the kind of activity that we see in Oakland now with the gun violence.
We're suffering as a people. We're hurt, we're traumatized. This is not what we want.
Nearby business owners want more police patrols and the city to invest more money in violence prevention.
Oakland has a very holistic approach to reducing gun violence called Ceasefire. And we have gotten national headlines. We cut gun violence in half in Oakland, and we've kept it there for many years until the pandemic.
The mayor says they'll put more resources into Ceasefire to try to stop the violence. Neighbors say this has to stop.
Yeah, I don't go out past 9 o'clock because too much activity. There's too much activity out here, and it's just too dangerous.
Business owners on this block say they survived the pandemic, but they worry they won't survive the violence because people are afraid to come down here. They hope people will support them by simply patronizing their businesses. In downtown Oakland, I'm Dahl Lane.
Story, multiple shootings on the southwest side early this morning. Two teenagers and an 11-year-old girl in the hospital right now. CBS 2's Asal Rezai has more from the University of Chicago Medical Center.
Yeah, we were at the Comer Children's Emergency area, but moved to this trauma entrance location after learning multiple victims from that shooting were brought here. I want to show you the heavy police presence we saw in the Gresham neighborhood. Our photographer on scene there saying more than 100 shell casings could be seen on the ground there near the Gresham School of Excellence. This is near South Peoria Street. Chicago police say a 29-year-old woman was taken to Christ Hospital in critical condition. A 16-year-old boy and a 17-year-old girl were brought here to UFC. The boy in serious condition while the girl is said to be okay. That triple shooting happening just 10 minutes after an 11-year-old girl was shot about a half a mile away near 86th and Halstead. Police say she was standing with several people when someone on foot came up firing several shots just before 1 o'clock this morning. She was shot in the leg and is recovering at Comer Children's Hospital, where she said to be in fair condition. Police so far have not said if the two shootings are connected. One emergency room nurse leaving her shift this morning tells me she was here when all of those victims came in.
Hey Marcus, good morning. Those numbers just keep going up today. They started on Friday around 6 p.m. ending this morning. As you mentioned, 99 people were shot. A lot of children involved in the weekend gun violence, at least 10 juveniles that we know of, and they were involved in those recent early morning shootings. Take a look at some of this video. This is on the west side in the Austin neighborhood just after midnight on Superior Street. Police say a 15-year-old and 16-year-old boy were walking in an alley when someone driving a gray sedan fired shots at them. The 16-year-old was hit in the ankle and he is okay, but the 15-year-old boy was shot several times and later died at Stroger Hospital. In the South Shore neighborhood, another pair of teenage boys were shot and killed. A 16-year-old and 17-year-old boy were killed near 79th and Luella after they went to the corner store Saturday evening. Police just released these pictures of the suspected shooter. You can see him running down an alley holding a gun. Another photo has a better view of his face.
This offender runs up with a gun and shoots and kills two of these guys for no reason at all.
Gangs, guns, and drugs, and no consequences when Chicago cops make arrests. Let's keep violent offenders in jail longer, and let's revamp the home monitoring program.
On Saturday night, a 3-year-old boy was shot and killed while riding in the car with his father in the Austin neighborhood. Police say the 27-year-old was the intended target and also hit. He drove his son straight to the hospital where he later died. The outrage over the toddler's death brought community activists together demanding the shooter come forward. Several community groups raised $10,000 as a reward for information leading to the suspect's arrest. Police have a lot of work to do, and they are counting on the public to help them. If you recognize the men in the surveillance video or have your own pictures, video, or information you can share, you're encouraged to call.